earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God.
Shannon Baptist Church, let's sing together as we sing today.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory.
lifted up. So when I fight,
so when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Sing it if you are for me.
Nothing can stand against the power of our God. In almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand.
Come on, we lift that up.
That once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who wore our sin. Shines for all to see. your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King.
Let's sing it together, the fear.
The fear that held us now gives way to Him who is our peace. His final breath upon the cross is now alive.
Come on, we stand in victory because of Jesus.
Your name.
Hey, well, it's going to be a special day. On the way to your seat, turn to your neighbor, tell them good morning. Awesome. Hey, church family, we are so glad that you're here today. As you grab your seat, if you could, at the end of each pew, there is an attendance pad. We want you to fill that out and turn that in the offering plate later in the service. And that is just a way for us as our church staff, as the leaders in our church, to know how to best serve and care for you. We want to know how to get in touch with you, how to pray for you. So please fill that out and put that in the offering plate later in the service. Hey, well, it's a joy to gather today. This week is actually something really special. You may not have heard about it, but in the lobby, you probably saw a huge booth that says Love Cola. This week is Love Cola Week. And so what that is churches all throughout our city are coming together and loving on schools, loving on people in our areas who need help. And it's just a task that we're all taking on together to show Columbia that the Church of God loves the people of Columbia. And so if you want to be a part of that, there's two ways that you can be a part of that. The first way you can be a part of that is praying. There's going to be volunteers from a bunch of churches this week that are out serving, out having conversations, gospel conversations with people. And we want you to be praying for them with us. And the second way is if you have time to serve this week, there are plenty of opportunities to get involved. The best way to do that is go to lovecola.org. Or you can go to the booth out there, and there are extra service projects that you can join in and help get to be a part of this week. And it's going to be an amazing week. I'm excited to hear the stories that are going to come from what God does this coming week in Columbia. Well, if you've been here before, or if it's your first time, you know that currently we do not have a pastor, but God is at work here at Shandon. That's what you need to know. If you don't hear anything else, God is at work, God is here, and God is not done. But today we get to hear from David Duncan from the Pastor Search Team. David's going to come. David's going to give us a brief update on exactly what God is doing through our Pastor Search Team and where they are at in that process. Thank you, David.
Thank you. I'm David Duncan, the chairman of the Pastor Search Team. This Thursday, we gave a update to the deacons. I characterized that update as a quick update, and after the meeting, one of the deacons came up and said, about that quick update you were giving, I just wanted to let you know that we're taking up a collection to buy you a watch and a dictionary. This is our fourth update to the congregation. I wanted to talk with you about three specific things. The first thing is what's happened to the candidates that members of Shandon have recommended. Each and every one of those candidates has had an opportunity for an interview with the president of Shepherd Staff, our consultant, to talk about the opportunity at Shandon and to be introduced into the Shandon process, into the Shepherd Staff process. So, secondly, what's Shepherd Staff doing? When we contracted with Shepherd Staff for their services, they immediately reached out into the Baptist and evangelical world with 8,000 contacts asking this question: are you interested in being senior pastor at Shandon, or do you know someone who is? 1,400 identifiable persons responded into their website. Over 500 of those actually looked at very specific information about Shandon, information going back 15 years. And 170 candidates have actually been in the application process. So a huge number of people. Shepherd Staff calls this a candidate-rich environment for Shandon, with a great many people interested. Shepherd Staff's process is a three-stage process. To make it through the three stages, candidates will have submitted a resume, multiple sermons will have been listened to. There's an extensive question and answer that they have to complete. They have three or more interviews with Shepherd staff members, including one interview that includes the spouse. There's a personality profile, a social media review, and reference checks. To the third stage, what is it that's going to happen next? Shepherd staff has begun presenting to us a small number of candidates that they think are good cultural fits for Shandon Baptist Church as the next senior pastor. We have hundreds of pages of interview notes, material, social media documents that our 11-member team is poring over this week. Beginning next week, a small welcome team will, by Zoom, interview each of those candidates. And the following week, the entire 11-member team will have a more extensive interview with all of those candidates. We are moving forward rapidly with those candidates. We do anticipate that some small number of additional candidates will be presented to us. But you might be asking, what can we do now? Well, you've been praying and encouraging us. Please continue to do that. Bathe us in prayer. We need your prayers, especially at this point in time. Be patient with us. We've been 6 months into this process. The last pastor search took 3 years. We are early into the process. I don't think this is a three-year process. We're moving quickly. Don't get ahead of us. Be patient. Be patient. Trust the process. Most importantly, beginning at this point, we will not discuss with you any particular candidate. We will not compare a candidate to other candidates or give you even general information about how candidates compare. It would violate our pledge of confidentiality during this particular point in time. But what will happen as decisions are made and as we come to a decision about a candidate to present to the church, I want you to remember, Shepherd staff is not selecting our pastor. The pastor search team doesn't finally select the pastor here. You and the congregation, after hearing a sermon preached in view of a call, will make the ultimate determination about the next senior pastor based on our recommendation. Again, keep us in prayer that we'll have discernment and unity in our process. Thank you all for your patience, and we'll be back with further updates in the not too distant future. Thank you.
Just like David asked, we ask that you would pray for our pastor search team as they continue to work to find the man that's going to lead our church. But we're also corporately going to pray together for the man and for our pastor search team. So let's pray together as we continue in worship. God, thank you so much that we can look back in time and see that you are a God who has never failed. You're a God who's never let us down. You're a God who will never leave or forsake us, Lord, and we know that is true for the future. Father, we see in your word that the gates of hell will not prevail against your church, Lord, and we believe that that is true for right here, for this place this morning. Lord, we pray for the pastor search team. We ask that you would give them guidance, that you would give them wisdom, discernment, God, and that you would be in full control of exactly what the future of it, our church, is. Lord, we love you so much. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Let's go ahead and stand as we continue to worship together. So, Father, we give you all the praise and all the glory, knowing that you are the only one who is worthy. Father, as we continue to worship, we worship through giving back of our tithes and offerings. We ask that you would bless what is given. God, we ask that every cent is given with a heart of knowing, Lord, that you are in control. God, that you are going to use this money for a purpose that's glorifying to you, and so that people would come to know you. Father, I pray that today as we give, Lord, we would learn something from it, remembering, Lord, that you first gave, and in return, Lord, you are worthy of our giving, Lord. So I pray that as we give, you'd be glorified, that you would be honored, Lord, so we give you all the praise and all the glory. It's in your name we pray. Amen. let's sing that chorus together one more time. Continue to worship as we celebrate baptism together. You can be seated.
Well, good morning, Shannon family. We have the honor of being able to celebrate baptism today. So why don't you tell your church family your name? So this is Luke. Luke is a senior at the University of South Carolina. And Luke really grew up around church. He grew up understanding a lot of the things about who Jesus was and what Jesus had done. But growing up, Luke kind of really, the word he used to me was self-reliant. He was very reliant on himself. He thought when he had a problem, he looked at himself for the answers and really was pretty consumed with approval of others. Right, and so Luke grew up and kind of was just living the college experience. And then this past summer, his mom actually helped Luke get connected to a group that met with Shannon College. And there, really, for the first time, Luke understood the weight of what it meant that Jesus lived the perfect life that he could never live, died the death that he deserved to die, and raised to walk in new life. And really, this summer, for the first time, like, Luke decided, hey, I want to go all in with Jesus. And so, yeah, give it up for Luke. And so, Luke, I want to ask you before your church family, who is it that you have decided to follow?
Jesus Christ.
Well, it is my honor then, brother, to baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in new life.
We're going to spend some sincere time in the book of Hebrews, and today we'll be looking at Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, and let me see if I explain to you why. It all begins with, I know that you folks have used GPS. I understand that. You take it for granted, but if you look at me, I remember when they first came out, and it was the best thing on the face of this earth. We had somebody that tells me where to go on a regular basis, could tell me what the speed limit is, and would lead me down some dirt roads that didn't go anywhere. That happens from time to time. You know, that's kind of all part of it. But man, what a great thing. When my daughter, who was a sold drugs. That sounds a little bit odd, but she does. She was a pharmaceutical rep, and she went to Orangeburg, never been to Orangeburg in her life. And she said that TPS saved her life, so she found that first office, that first doctor, just like that, no problem. Went in, put the next one in, went there, put the next one in. After lunch, she put one in and ended up right next door to the doctor she saw the first time. I mean, she says, I got to get this thing in order. But it took her everywhere. GPS is important, but let me tell you why I like it being married. This is really important for me. My wife, I look at her from time to time. I said, you like to go out to eat? Sure. And she said, what are my choices? And for years, she wanted me to run down the restaurants that would be available to her around our house. They hadn't changed in 30 years. And so the GPS gives me an opportunity to ask her this question. What kind of food do you want? If she does, I'll just hit it. I said, here's your list. Pick one. So she could just press a button. We're on the way. We're going. So I believe in these, in a GPS. You know how they work? You understand this? Now, some of you folks who are in that kind of thing, you do. But, you know, worry about the satellites, something I can't see. In fact, as you look at these things, you can't use them without acquiring a satellite. You ever notice that? You're in a parking garage somewhere, and sometimes they say, we can't acquire it. We can't do it. So it's really a strange thing to understand that there was something designed that could only work like that, which means that if I wanted directions from a rock, it's not going to happen. If I wanted directions even from myself, it's not going to happen. It all has to come through the design of the unit itself. Well, you know what? You were designed as a Christian, as a child of God, to acquire Jesus Christ. And there is no other thing that we can do. There's no other way we can go to get direction for our life and purpose and meaning for what we're about other than Jesus Christ himself. And that is the purpose of this book, because it shows us how we depend on God, how all this works together. It shows us how the guidance system of God works in our lives personally and as a group. It's an important thing to understand. And so let me just tell you, the starting point in Hebrews is with Jesus Christ himself on the cross, who forgives you, who gives you an eternal life, and those are the best of all gifts that come with God. But that's not all there is. He also adds a calling and a purpose and a meaning to your life. Now, you know that eternity begins the very day you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You become a part of the kingdom at that time. And so he's pouring things into your life to make you understand where your strengths are, what you're supposed to be about, why you were born. And this is what the book of Hebrews leads us to understand. Let me explain the title of the book to you. Do you know who the first Hebrew was? It was Abraham. Now, Abraham basically defines the term, because God went to Abraham and said, now, what I want you to do is I want you to leave where you are. And the word means over the river to the other side. He says, I want you to leave what you've depended on since you were a child. I want you to leave those things that you thought were good, and they are, but they're not best for you, Abraham. But I want you to leave. Turn them loose, and I want you to go across that river. And that's what the word means, Hebrews. Hebrew, that's what he did. Now, do understand that some people think that they can go and not leave. They're two separate things. There's some things that you just have to turn loose and realize that these things are holding you back from what God would have you to do and to be. And so you have to turn some things loose. And then he told Abraham, I'm not going to even tell you where to go. The only thing I want you to do is trust me. Did you know that God does the same thing with us? Trust is the greatest way to please God. And he won't tell us destination. He just says, for today, you trust me. Now then God said, now Abraham, if you do that, I'm going to do three things in your life. Number one, I'm going to bless you. Number two, you're going to be a blessing to others. And it's going to all come through you. And number three, whoever curses you, I'm going to curse. And whoever blesses you, I'm going to bless. He says, Abraham, this means that I'm on your side. Now, let me ask you something. If God's on your side, seems like to me this isn't rocket science. Seems like to me that you're at a pretty good place. But God said, you do these two things, and I will do these three. You leave, and you go. I will bless you, bless others, and protect you. Now, that's Old Testament. But it's not. Because if you look over in the book of Galatians, we are reminded that we are heirs of Abraham's direction and promise. What God said to Abraham in that promise is ours. And what Hebrews, that's right, it means to leave and to go to the other side. That's what the book means. And it tells us how all this works together. So that's why we need to take some time and walk through this to make sure that we understand. Now, the first audience for this book, commentaries will tell you, were the Jews in Rome. They had received Jesus Christ personally as their Lord and Savior, but they had a hard time getting loose of the sacrifices and getting loose of the law in order to have a personal sacrifice with God. So that's why the book was written, is that when you have trouble with religion and you're a religious person and you think your whole job is simply to make yourself acceptable to God and somehow you can do it, where He'll love you so much that He'll bring you into His presence, that's religion. God says, I want you folks to turn that loose. And I want you to go and have a personal, daily, trusting relationship with Jesus Christ. It was such a change for them to experience. So we have it like this. We're in Hebrews chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. Good place to start. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, and through Him, He made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of His being, sustaining all things by His powerful word. And after He had provided purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty in heaven. The first thing that jumps out in this passage, in the very first three verses, is that God speaks. Did you see that? God has spoken, it says. It says in verse 1, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times in various ways. You think God speaks? You believe He speaks? He does. There's a group of deists, though. And Benjamin Franklin was one. Thomas Jefferson was one who believed that God did create everything. He does exist. But what He did, He wound everything up and turned it loose. And then God went back and watched it unfold. We don't have that type of model in Scripture anywhere. We have a God who communicates with us exactly. In fact, this passage says it happened in the past, which means this God speaking thing is not a new thing. It's been around a long, long, long time. Go back to Genesis. Who was it that Adam and Eve walked with and talked with in the garden? It was God Himself. And it didn't just stop there. We read the text, it says, and in many times and in various ways, which means God talked to Cain, He talked to Abel, He talked to Noah, He talked to Abraham. And when He came, He answered people in the place that they found themselves, really at the points where they would listen the most. You remember little Samuel? He was answering the direction of somebody in that temple right there, and he was in his bed, and sure enough, somebody called out for him. He was in tune, but it was God Himself speaking to him. You have Daniel in a vision, and Joseph and Gideon in dreams, and you have Jacob with angels. But God has spoken in so many ways. And the verse goes on to say, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets. You see, these were unusual events with unusual people that God spoke to personally. And what they did, they were so moved by what God said, they wrote it down. And that's what we have. This is called the Bible. And it's interesting that as you look at the history of the Bible, you find that everything, even though these people were thousands of years apart and they were hundreds of miles apart, that it all is the same. God speaking. He never veered. This is a huge way in which we listen. Let me ask you a question. We're talking about God speaking. How are your prayers these days? Do you get a little stale from time to time? You tired of saying, "Now lay me down to sleep"? Are you getting tired of that one? I think I would if I were you. Put it away. Let me tell you something. Prayers come alive when all of a sudden, in the middle of your prayer, you say, "God, I want to thank you for speaking to me. I want to thank you that, Lord, you didn't bring me here to wander and wonder in the darkness. That, God, you didn't leave me without a conversation." Let me tell you what, when you understand that God gave you two ears and one mouth, that's a hint about what you need to do the most. And with him too. I don't know, a lot of people think that prayer is a monologue. It's a dialogue. It's a life of realizing that God speaks. And when you stand up even to walk away from that prayer time, he talks all day long. It's on a daily basis. It changes everything. The second thing I need to tell you, that this passage is moving for you to take home, is that God speaks personally to you in Christ. He is the one that we're designed to be in touch with. And right there, it changes everything. Verse 1 again. Chapter 1, it says, "In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times in various ways." But here's the biggest word in the first three verses. But. B-U-T. Three little tiny letters. But this is a huge, huge word. But in these last days, let's stop right there. How many of you have ever heard anybody say, "Well, you know, they wrote that 2,000 years ago, this thing about last days, and boy, it never came for them. You reckon it's late? Were they wrong?" No, they weren't wrong. In fact, they were dead right. We are in the last days. You see, the Bible is written like a play in a lot of ways, and God has it divided into sections. And basically, you have the creation act, where we go from Adam and Eve all the way to Noah. Then we have this covenant time. And then we have the time where Moses writes the law, which is the third act. And then God went quiet for 400 years. He didn't speak. But when he spoke the next time, he brought us into what's known as the last times. We have been in the last time for 2,000 years. Not only is the clock ticking, but the checklist is being checked off even as we sit here. It's happening. We are in last times. And in these last times, God has chosen to speak to us through his Son, out loud and personal. And let me show you how the last times began. God wanted, and he could have used thunder, he could have used lightning, he could have scared you to death, but that's not what he wanted to do. Because these are last times, this is the last opportunity in the life of human beings that they can ever make this decision. God came to reveal his heart. His heart. He doesn't want you to run. He says, "Come to me. All you who are burdened and heavy laden, come to me." Now, how did he do that? Verse 2, "But in these last days he has spoken to us by his Son." I don't even know how I can explain this to you. When I was at Ashley River, I was in my office, and this was before everybody had a cell phone. And it was the folks downtown, and they were trying to find a family in our church who had a son to get killed on his way to Edisto. And a drunk driver had veered and hit their car. Now, these boys got off the road, but it killed all three of them. He hit them head on. And they said, we've sent a policeman around to their house. They're not home. Do you know where they are?" Of course, I didn't know where they were, but I said, I will find out. I couldn't find them either, so I went and sat on the front porch, knowing that they would probably be home any minute. And sure enough, they were at the medical university downtown, I found out later, and they were sitting there when the ambulance left to go pick up their son's body. They didn't know what it was. They could hear the siren outside the window. They had no idea. No idea. And so I sat there, longest day of my ministry ever. And I watched them drive in the driveway. They knew something was up. And I told them the message. Do you think that this family, John and Sherry, ever really would have been willing for their son to die? You think they'd ever be as parents, the kind of parents that would give up their son to die? You see, we as parents, we do something else. We want to see them grow up. We want to see kids unfold. We want to see them get, we're excited about how it's all going to turn out. Now, we're going to dedicate some babies next week. You ask those parents, would you die for that baby? Oh, yeah. Then ask them, don't do it. Would you give me that baby? So that I can take its life. You see how foreign this is? There's nothing about what I'm saying that we can comprehend. Then there was John and Patsy. They lost their son just downtown Charleston. Drunk driver ran a stop sign, and Julie and Jay were in the car. Jay was killed. Julie survived. The same with them. There's nothing in us. We would die for our children, but for our children to die for us, that's an entirely different thing. All right, listen. Hold on. John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he, what's the next word? You think you love God? You think you love people? You have no idea of the kind of love that God came to us with. To give up your baby? To give up your child? And to offer him as a sacrifice for those drunk drivers? 1 John 4:10, this is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. This is a whole new way of thinking. Nobody's ever seen anything like this. These scriptures present us with something that nobody could ever possibly imagine happening. But when God wanted us to know his heart, he did this to show us how great a love he had. Now, Jesus is God, the second person there in that Trinity. Jesus is all of God, and he came here, and God gave his son so that you wouldn't run from him. So that you know of a love when he extends his arm, he says, come to me, don't run, come to me. I love you more than you could ever imagine, more than you love yourself, but more than I even love my own son. Come. Third thing these verses tell us. Verse 2, part B says, through whom he made the universe. Did you know that? That Jesus made the universe? Next time you see a comet in the sky and it surprises you, truly you can say this. Thank you, Jesus. That was pretty neat. He made the universe. It says in verse 3 that the sun is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. The word sustaining means holding together. You wouldn't be able to sit in these seats. You wouldn't be able to be who you are. Everything in your body would not work would not function. Wouldn't even stay together. It's Jesus Christ holding you right now, and you didn't even ask for it, but he's holding all these things together. John 1:3. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. Colossians 1:16. For by him all things were created. Can we settle it once and for all? Don't take anything less. Don't take anything less. Don't worship things God, through Jesus Christ, created, like the trees and the rocks and crystals and all of those other things. Angels. People. Don't worship anything. There's only one being. Years ago, H.G. Wells gave a list of the 10 most important men in history. He put Jesus Christ as number one. Jesus Christ should not have been on the list. Because he's not Jesus the Great. Might be Charlemagne the Great or Peter the Great or even Alexander the Great. But I want to tell you something. It is not Jesus the Great. He is not on that list in my mind and heart. No. He is the Savior. He owns it all. And he is the only designed piece, person, and figure that you can acquire that will give you direction. Let me tell you what, Napoleon, if you go back and look at the history of how many families he destroyed, both in his own army and the people he attacked, the things that he did when he rampaged towns, and he did it because he was lost. Because I want to tell you something, if you don't have a GPS connection, you know, you can be lost. But if you're not connected with Jesus Christ, you are lost, and deadly and dangerous. And that's exactly what Napoleon was. They finally got him and they took him and put him in exile. And for the first time, he picked up a Bible and he read it. And he started acquiring that connection with Jesus Christ. And here's what he wrote. I know men. I tell you that Jesus Christ is not a mere man. Superficial minds see a resemblance between Christ and the founders of empires and the gods of other religions. That resemblance does not exist, Napoleon said. There is between Christianity and every other religion a distance of infinity. We can say to the altars of every other religion, you are neither gods nor the agents of deity. You are the missionaries. You are but missionaries of falsehood molded from the same clay with the rest of the mortals. You see, if he had Christ in his life early, none of this would have taken place. None of the things that he did would have taken place. But I leave all of that to a Christ that loves Napoleon more than I could ever possibly imagine. But this is how it is for us. I'm going to tell you what, without Christ in your life, it's like an alphabet without letters. It's like math without numbers. It's like music without notes. You have nothing. And Christ brings us here. And God says, if you will acquire me, there's nothing else that you're designed to do. If you will acquire me, I'm going to do two things in your life that I'm going to ask you about. I want you to leave those things that you've depended on all your life. You might think it's money. You might think it's ambition. It might be the way you dress, your house, your car. I'm going to ask you to leave all of those things. Leave them. And understand that that's not number one in your life. And I want you to go across the river. I want you to go and embrace me in the personal relationship. And I'm going to lead you to some places day by day. And I probably won't tell you the destination yet. But I want you to trust me on a regular basis. And God says, I want to make you a Hebrew. And I'll do three things for you. Number one, I'll bless you, I'll bless others through you, and I will protect you. Those are the three things. And the place to begin with acquiring your purpose, with acquiring why you were born, with acquiring is going to the cross and accepting the forgiveness of Christ, God's Son, and letting Him bestow upon you eternal life, the two greatest blessings that could ever come to any human being on the face of this earth. And then He'll call you to leave and to go as part of the purpose of your life. It's had it all starts. So I beg you, please, don't settle for anything less but Jesus Christ. And if you've never acquired Christ, if you've never brought Him into your life, He's waiting for you to invite. You're designed for this. All you have to do is connect with Him and tell Him that you want Him to be your Lord and your Savior. And He will do that right now. But some of you other folks in here who've been Christians a long time, did you acquire Him? It's a daily thing. Did you get that daily bread, that manna from heaven where the roots don't belong on the earth, but they come from God before you even walked in here today? Where are you right now? Once you're saved, this action of acquiring God and getting directions for your day become a part of who we are, and God speaks to us. You want to hear Him? Would you bow your head and close your eyes if you've never invited Him into your life, if you've never grabbed Him and held Him, and Him held you? You don't have to be scared of Him. He loves you so much that He's going to give to you what you need. As Christians here in this place, maybe right now more than ever, you need to reacquaint yourself with a Christ personally. Let Him embrace you, and you embrace Him. Let's bow for prayer. Father, I want You to forgive us, please, for being so proud that we think we can handle this on our own. But Lord, right now we bow before You, and You're all there is. We pray as we touch You, that Lord, You speak to us and fill us with Your word, with the movement of Your life, and the direction that we need for the rest of the day that we have here. Thank You for the fact that, Lord, when we seek You, that we find simply by the design that You've made us to be. And God, when we make those requests, You come immediately. Thank You for the power of Your life in us. Lord, we know that You're speaking to us now. And God, I want to thank You for the Christ and the cross that begins it all. It's in the name of Your Son that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we close together in song.
'Cause Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your Spirit, I will rise from the earth.
Amen. Let's give the Lord just a praise. I'm so thankful, Dr. Carney, for just the reminder of who Christ is for each one of us, who he is for us as a church. And we're going to celebrate that as we send several of our own from Shannon this week over to Africa. So if our mission team that's going with Empower One to Uganda could make their way to the front so we can pray for you. You guys, this is Earlene Stack, Chris Ransom, Siatu Peebles, Joanne Furster, Lori Christensen, John Barnes, Earl Utsi, Bruce Auld, Will Davis, and Caleb Reiser. John Barnes will be the trip leader. We don't have any pro missionaries. We just got faithful Shannon members that want to give their lives for taking the gospel. How awesome is that? Would you pray for these folks? They leave on Saturday. They've got a 36-hour journey just to get to Uganda. Then they got an overnight, and they got another flight up north to the northern part. They'll be in one of the most densely populated Muslim communities, or most densely Muslim communities of Uganda, doing evangelism, church encouragement. They're doing a women's conference to empower women. They'll be going to Bidi Bidi refugee camps to encourage churches, but some significant work. October 8th through 18th, would you pray for them every day? I know Allison's going to probably put something on Shannon Missions so that you can find out information about them. So we're going to close by celebrating Jesus and the opportunity we have to take his gospel overseas. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you so much for this team. Thank you for putting them together. Thank you for calling them at one point in their lives where they could recognize that they just needed Jesus Christ to be Savior and that you are the only one. I pray, Lord, that as they prepare this week, that you would prepare their hearts because they're in your word. They're praying. They're on their knees, submitting to your authority. I pray for every little logistic and all the logistics, all the details that have to come together to make everything happen this week. And then, Lord, as we send them as a church, we just pray that they would go in power. We know that there's all this stuff that we do, but we know that all of the power comes from God Almighty through Jesus Christ. And I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit, they would be sent from this church, and that in that power, we would pray daily. Lord, we love you, and we commit this team to you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you were here today and you had something go on in your heart that made you just feel like you needed to take a next step towards walking with Christ, or you have a question, go through these middle doors to our Next Step Center and just have a little conversation with the folks there who will receive you well. Shannon, it's been great worshiping with you today. You are dismissed.